Well, this morning, we're going to start a new series. We're starting a series that we actually did last year called Rhythms, Sacred Practices That Renew the Soul. So rhythm is defined as a strong, regular, repeated pattern of movement or sound. Another definition for rhythm is a regularly recurring sequence of events or actions or processes. Now, I don't know about you, but when I hear the word rhythm, my mind most quickly goes to music. Like, I most typically associate rhythm with music. But the reality is, this idea of rhythm, regularly recurring sequences or patterns, can be found throughout all of creation almost. There are rhythms and patterns all over creation. We have hourly, daily, weekly, monthly, yearly rhythms that we follow. Our brains actually regulate our alertness and our sleepiness according to a 24-hour cycle called a circadian rhythm. And a lot of times, if you struggle, this is not the only reason, but if you sometimes struggle with sleep, it's because we're fighting against that natural rhythm. As our body is naturally releasing melatonin, telling our body to begin to calm down and prepare for sleep, we sometimes maybe are looking at our phones and the blue light is telling our brain to wake up. So we're telling our brain, or what we're looking at on our phones, to wake up while our body's trying to wind down. There's this rhythm. Everything from our blood pressure to our body temperature seems to follow a rhythmic cycle. And we tend to be healthiest when we follow these natural rhythms. Our bodies tend to be healthiest when we try to live in sync with these rhythms. Well, I want to suggest to you that this is also true spiritually, that for our spiritual lives, our inner lives, there are rhythms with which we can live in sync with. For centuries, the Christian faith has identified this need for the believer to cultivate the presence of God in their life, to create space for the grace of God to fill. There are also these tried and true practices for centuries that believers have found are helpful practices, helpful ways to invite the presence of God, to enter into and experience the presence of God. And these practices are often called spiritual disciplines. Now, I don't know how those words sit with you, but I don't know if it's my generation or what. I just sometimes I hear spiritual disciplines, and I don't necessarily love the term. Like, there's so much baggage that comes with it. Spiritual. Like, well, what if I'm not that spiritual? Like, it just sounds a little intimidating. How spiritual do you have to be? And, you know, we really shouldn't compare ourselves anyways. Like, that's another sermon, though. But spiritual and then disciplines. Is that, like, punishment or self-control? I know it's only February of 2024, but, like, last night we were with our life group, and the host family made these amazing carnitas tacos, and I was having a hard time not eating too. Actually, I did eat one. I'll just be honest with you. I ate more than I should have. I have a hard time, like, self-discipline. You have to be really spiritual, and you have to be really self-disciplined. Sometimes that word can be a little intimidating. And so I want to talk about it for the next couple weeks in terms of this idea of rhythm or habits and practices, these rhythms that when we practice them sort of bring us in tune with the melody of heaven. Now, I will be honest with you, music, if you play an instrument, it does take a degree of self-discipline and regular practice. That is involved in it. You have to practice these rhythms with something of a regularity for them to be meaningful. But the more you practice, the more fluent you become. And with music, the more fluent you are, the more free you are to jazz it up sometimes. The more fluent you are with the rhythms, the more freedom you have. So last year, around this time, we did the series last year, and we covered, so there are a lot of different spiritual disciplines or rhythms. And we covered four last year. We talked about silence and solitude. Really important for a lot of the, sort of one of the foundational pieces of practicing some of the other spiritual disciplines is being able to retreat and enter into a place where you're stilling yourself and you're practicing silence and solitude in God's presence. We talked about prayer last year. And we talked about a rhythm of hospitality and a rhythm of generosity. Today, we'll talk about engaging Scripture. Or, you know, no surprise, reading your Bible or engaging the Bible. Now, when we talk about that, though, this is one of my study Bibles I have. I don't often use this one because it's big, it's heavy, it's a hardcover. I mean, it's just, I think when we talk about engaging Scripture, this is sort of a visual illustration of, I think, how we feel. Like, that's a little bit overwhelming. I mean, maybe some of you read novels that are this thick on a regular, but I don't typically read very often books that are this thick. And, like, where do you start? And then there's things, I mean, we don't want to admit this in church, but there's things that I don't understand in here. Like, it's, it can be kind of overwhelming to talk about engaging Scripture. Like, so where do we start? Where do we begin? I want to talk, and I want to have some practical ways that we can regularly engage a rhythm of Scripture in our lives. But before that, I want to show a video that sort of captures a broad overview of what the Bible is. So, I think we're ready to cue. Are we good? Cue the video. Check this video out, and then we'll talk about some practical ways to engage Scripture.
The Bible. It's one of the most influential books in human history. It explores the big questions of why we exist. It's inspired many people to do amazing things and confused many others. And you've probably got one sitting around somewhere. So, what is the Bible actually? Well, the Bible is a small library of books that all emerged out of the history of the people of ancient Israel. And in one sense, they were just like any other ancient civilization. But among them were a long line of individuals called prophets. And they viewed Israel's story as anything but ordinary. They saw it as a central part of what God was doing for all of humanity. And these prophets were literary geniuses.
Really?
Yeah, they expertly crafted the Hebrew language to write epic narratives, very sophisticated poetry. They were masters of metaphor and storytelling, and they leveraged all of this to explore life's most complicated questions about death and life and the human struggle.
So, there's a lot of different authors writing this book.
Yeah, and these texts were produced over a 1,000-year period, starting with Israel's origins in Egypt, then leading up to their kingdom with their first temple. But eventually, they were conquered by the Babylonians, who took them away into exile. Then, at a crucial moment in their history, many Israelites returned to their land. They built a second temple, they reformed their identity, and this is when the Jewish Scriptures began to be formed into the shape that we have them today.
Okay, the Jewish Bible. What's in it?
Well, in Hebrew, it's called by an acronym, Tanakh. The T stands for Torah, sometimes called the Law. That's Israel's five-book foundation story. The N stands for Nevi'im, the Hebrew word for prophets. And this section consists of the historical books that tell Israel's story from the prophet's point of view. Then you get the poetic books of the prophets themselves. The K stands for Ketuvim, the Hebrew word for writings. This is a diverse collection of poetic books, wisdom books, and more narratives. And the Jewish people believe that through all of these literary works, God speaks to his people.
Now, there were other Jewish writings being produced during the Second Temple period as well.
Yeah, a really diverse group of texts. And these two were highly valued in Jewish communities. And there was debate from ancient times about whether or not some of these should be considered part of their scriptures.
So, this is a lot of different writings over a long period of time. Why did they put them all together like this?
Well, altogether, these texts tell an epic story about how God is working through these people to bring order and beauty out of the chaos of our world. And it all builds up to a hope for a new leader who would come and renew all creation. And then the Tanakh concludes, and this leader never comes.
So it's an expertly crafted work, but it's missing an ending?
That's exactly right. Now, a few centuries later, a Jewish prophet comes onto the scene named Jesus of Nazareth. He claimed he was carrying the Tanakh story forward.
Yeah, so Jesus did a bunch of cool stuff, was killed, but his followers claimed he was alive from the dead.
Yeah, they said that Jesus was that long-awaited leader who would restore the world. And so his earliest followers, called apostles, they composed new literary works about the story of Jesus. They called these Good News, or the Gospel. They formed an account called Acts about the spread of the Jesus movement outside of Israel. And then they circulated letters to different Jesus communities all around the ancient world.
And they saw these writings as part of the Scripture.
Yeah, the apostles wrote all of this as the fulfillment of that epic story found in the Tanakh. and they were continuing the literary genius of the Jewish tradition. They also believed that God was speaking to his people through these texts alongside the scriptures of Israel.
So that's the Old and New Testament. But what did the early Christians think of the other Second Temple literature?
Well, different groups had different views about some of these books, but we know they read them and valued these texts because they passed them along with the Jewish scriptures.
Okay, so we've got the Tanakh, the Jewish scriptures. We got these other Second Temple period works. Then the writing of the apostles by Jesus. And that's a lot of literature, so what's in my Bible?
So the Christian movement has taken different forms over 2,000 years, and from the beginning, all Christians recognized the Tanakh and the New Testament as scripture. And for centuries, much of the Second Temple literature was read as part of the biblical tradition. The Catholic Church eventually made it official and called some of the books from this collection the Deuterocanonical Books. Some Orthodox churches used even more books from the Second Temple literature. And then in the 1500s, during the Reformation, Protestant Christians wanted to go back to the oldest writings of the prophets and apostles, so they accepted only the Old and New Testament.
Okay, I think I got it. But how did the collection of books produced over 1,000 years by all these different authors tell one unified story?
Yeah, that's the question we'll address in our next video.
That was a very brief overview of the history, but that's what we have. The Old and New Testament were, this is a collection of 66 books written over a significant period of human history, over 1,000 years, and written in Hebrew and Greek by over 35 different authors, through which we believe God reveals his nature, his character, and his redemptive purposes. I love what N.T. Wright in Simply Christian writes. He says, picking it up, you need to remind yourself that you hold in your hands not only the most famous book in the world, but one which has extraordinary power to change lives, to change communities, to change the world. It's done it before. It can do it again. The psalmist in Psalm 119, 15 through 16 writes, I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. What would it look like for you to be able to echo the words of this psalmist? I will not neglect your word. In Hebrews 4:12, the author claims that the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates, even dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges thoughts and attitudes of the heart. This is a really poetic way of saying this cuts to the heart of the matter. That scripture, when we open it and we read it, it has the ability to read us. That if you allow it, it can penetrate to these deep places in our hearts and our lives. Worshippers of God and followers of Jesus have long recognized the value and the importance of engaging a regular rhythm of reading scripture. And here's the thing, not only do we believe you will come to know God more, but we actually believe that we can be transformed by it, that we can become formed into the image of Jesus Christ as we engage scripture. But before we talk about some practical ways to do this, I want to talk about some dangers to avoid. Because I think we can approach scripture, and there's a couple things that could trip us up as we do. First of all, I want to share three of those. Number one, elevating the written word over the living word. In John's Gospel, John chapter 5, speaking to some Pharisees and religious leaders, Jesus says to them, "You study the scriptures diligently because you think that in them you have eternal life. These are the very scriptures that testify about me." The purpose of the scriptures is to point us to Jesus, to point to the revelation of God in the person of Jesus Christ. The scriptures are written revelation of God. Jesus is the living revelation of God. The author of Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 2, opens this way. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets, at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, who he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the universe. The scriptures point to Jesus. And sometimes I think we can get so focused on being biblical or the Bible that we elevate the written word over the living word. Sometimes I feel like people are so focused on being biblical that they miss being Christ-like. And I would look at Christ-likeness and sort of measure that according to Galatians 5, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Sometimes I feel like there are people I've encountered, you know, influencers, blogs online, or people, YouTube videos of people are really, they're really seem to be so focused on being right about what the Bible says that they've lost any sense of being kind or gentle. The reason I think this is such an important danger and caution, not just because I think it's important that we reflect Christ into Christ's life, but all throughout the gospel, all throughout the New Testament, the scribes, the Pharisees, the teachers of the religious law were experts in what the Bible said. They were experts. They had huge chunks of the Hebrew scriptures memorized. And time again, they had an argument for what the Bible said, and they had an argument for what the Messiah was supposed to do. They had a case for why Jesus was this dangerous rabbi, but they were wrong. They knew what the Bible said, but they missed the Messiah. And time again, when Jesus has these confrontations with the Pharisees, the scribes, and the religious leaders, he's often confronting them about their rigidity about what the Bible says at the expense of loving their neighbor. So I think this, as we come to Scripture, this is one of the dangers. We don't want to fall in line with the scribes and the Pharisees and the teachers of the law that Jesus was often sort of reprimanding. We don't want to elevate the written word over the living word. Number two, a danger to avoid is not taking the Bible seriously on its own terms. It is living and active. So contrary to the witty popular saying, maybe you've heard it, maybe you haven't, but the Bible is not basic instructions before leaving Earth. It's not that. It's not a manual. It's not a textbook. It's not a reference book to answer all of life's questions. The Bible, again, is a collection of 66 books written by at least 40 different authors over a span of over 1,500 years. That is a large span of time. The scriptures were written in specific yet varying cultural and historical contexts by human authors who were inspired by the Spirit. I will say it next because I think it's so important. The scriptures were written in specific yet varying historical and cultural contexts. The time period and context of Abraham was vastly different than that of Isaiah or Jeremiah. There's years of history that span those times. It's different. There's specific historical and cultural contexts. And written by these human authors, but inspired by the Spirit. Now, just like the incarnation of Jesus, the revelation of the living Word, Jesus, part of what we claim is true, one of the Apostles' Creed, is he was born of a woman. In the same way that the revelation of God in the person of Jesus did not entirely bypass the human agency, the written revelation of God did not bypass the human agency of the authors. The cultural context, the language of the authors, even their writing style, some of their understandings of their time, God did not bypass the human authors through whom he inspired and revealed himself. You can see more clearly in the original language, but even in English, you can see that John's gospel and his writing style is very different from Mark's gospel. Paul's writings and his letters, the vocabulary he uses, it's very different from Peter's. There is something about the human agency through whom God revealed himself that is part of the revelation. Not only that, there are also different genres of literature within the Bible. So you don't interpret poetry in the same way you would historical narrative. Taking into account when we come to Scripture, even the genre in which it was written is important. And as that video said, these authors, this is a literary masterpiece. And the more I study it, and the more you even study the original language, the more profound it is. It's just, it's incredible. The literary devices included, there's hyperbole, there's figures of speech, there's metaphor, there's wordplay, there's dramatic storytelling, and so much more in this literary masterpiece that we call the Bible. And there is a both and mystery. Both and mystery in which the revelation of God is mediated through human agency. And I believe we do a disservice to the Bible to only approach it from our modern American English sort of thinking minds and then flatten out or iron out the humanity in the process. In the same way that we miss something about the revelation of God in Jesus if we don't hold that he is fully God and fully man, I think we miss something if we try to remove the human element of Scripture through whom God revealed himself. There is a divine human mystery in the revelation of Scripture. And I believe we need to take that seriously. I believe it is more faithful to the biblical text to wrestle with this divine human agency than to flatten it out and iron it out. I believe it is more faithful to the biblical text to do the hard work of understanding the historical, cultural, and literary context of the text. Now, I know what you're thinking. So, Anthony, you're saying, like, I need to go to seminary to approach Scripture. Like, I need to be a Bible scholar, is what you're saying? No, that's not what I'm saying. My kids are young, and they're still learning a lot of things about life. And my son learned to read this year. As they learn things, what tends to happen is they think they know quite a bit about life. Sometimes they think they've learned things, and so they get a little too big for the britches. You know what I mean? And they just don't know. They have this sort of ignorant unawareness of how much they still don't know yet about life. So I'm not saying we need to be, it's not bad that my kids are learning. It's not bad that they still need to learn. But there needs to be a bit of a humility and understanding of what this is when we approach it. Let's not get too big for our britches because we've been to a bunch of Bible studies our whole lives. Let's understand this is a beautiful mystery that includes so much historical and cultural and even just original language. We can always be learners. And let's approach it and take it seriously on its own terms. That this is a powerful, beautiful, literary, inspired, spirit-infused masterpiece. And let's take that seriously and not flatten it out and oversimplify it. Thirdly, another danger to avoid is self-righteous pride. In 1 Corinthians 8, Paul writes, "We know that we all possess knowledge, but knowledge puffs up, while love builds up. Those who think they know something do not yet know as they ought to know." So one of the dangers as we engage Scripture more, as we read it more, as we study it more, as we maybe even memorize more of it, is we can begin to get self-righteous in our spiritual practice or a little bit prideful in our biblical knowledge. And it's just important to remember that the goal of engaging Scripture is not to know the Bible more, it's to know Jesus more. The goal of engaging Scripture is not to be a good person, but to be a transformed person. And one of the marks of transformation is humility. So let's not approach it and allow pride, self-righteous pride, because, oh, I read my Bible every day, and so I'm pretty spiritual with those spiritual disciplines, or I've read all this, and I know a lot about what the Bible says, and I can quote all these scriptures that I've memorized. Let's not get puffed up. Love builds up. So some of the dangers to avoid as we approach Scripture: elevating the written word over the living word, not taking the Bible seriously on its own terms, and self-righteous pride. We want to avoid those things as we approach Scripture. Well, what are some practical ways that we can engage Scripture? I want to share some practical, hopefully for real, they will be practical for you, that we'll talk about. And I'm just going to confess to you, I had a cold earlier this week, and so it's like, you're probably hearing that, and I'm sorry. In my own head, my voice sounds very annoying, so I'm sorry if it's annoying to listen to me right now. So I want to talk about the rhythm of engaging Scripture. What are some ways we can incorporate a regular rhythm of engaging Scripture? I'm going to use sort of a photography metaphor. I thought about finding an old camera we had and bringing it up, but I don't know where it's at, actually. It's probably in a closet somewhere. But I want to talk about taking a snapshot, zooming out, zooming in, and then develop. So a snapshot. A snapshot is a quick picture, a memorable picture we take of a fun, encouraging, or even funny moment, and we just take a quick sort of snapshot of it. A snapshot of Scripture is what I'm calling devotional reading. A lot of times, this devotional reading, we take those quick, smaller portions of Scripture, those memorable, those encouraging, those uplifting verses, like, I can do all things through Christ, for I know the plans I have for you, those inspiring, very quotable Scriptures. And devotional reading is one of the ways we can approach Scripture. One of the best ways to do this is to find a devotional that you connect with or that you like, or to get recommendations. And a lot of times, a devotional has a theme Scripture and then a chunk of a paragraph or a devotional thought about that Scripture. Maybe you read the context surrounding that devotional Scripture, the inspirational Scripture at the top. Maybe read a couple verses before or after, the whole chapter. But devotional reading is just sort of a quick snapshot of Scripture, and it's good, and a lot of times it builds us up. It encourages us, it renews our soul, it pulls out those Scriptures that most encourage us in our day-to-day lives. Another recommendation for that is the YouVersion Bible app. You can download that on your phone or on a tablet. We're not ready for that slide just yet. We'll come back to it. Thank you, though, because I have a laser pointer I'm excited to use for the slides. So, you can download the YouVersion Bible app, and they have all sorts of devotional plans that you can follow and find there. It's free. So, devotional reading is one way that you can approach Scripture. Another way is we can zoom out. When you zoom out, you get a big picture. You try to take more of it in. So, zooming out, a big picture reading or a book-by-book reading of Scripture. I'm a little bit partial to the zooming out reading because originally the Scriptures did not have chapter and verse divisions. Those came later to make it easier to kind of reference things. But originally, the books, like most books, were intended to be read as a whole. Paul's letters were intended to be read from beginning to end as a whole. And when we parse it out, sometimes we can miss things, especially with Paul. He builds these arguments, and if you jump into the middle of the argument to the exclusion of what he said before that, it's one of the ways we can misuse Scripture on accident is pulling things out of context. So zooming out is a really good way to approach Scripture to get a big picture reading. And I don't like to be dogmatic or rigid about these spiritual rhythms, so don't hear me being dogmatic about this. I would encourage every Jesus follower to once in their life, at least once in their life, read through the whole Bible. I think it would be really good. Again, I'm not being dogmatic about this. I don't want to put any rigid burden. I just think at least once every Jesus follower, we should read through the whole thing at one point in our life. And I would encourage a chronological reading plan because I didn't know this until much later in my life. Our Bibles are not arranged according to historical chronology. In the Old Testament, you have the Torah, then there's the historical books, then the wisdom literature or poetic books like Psalms and Proverbs, and then the major and minor prophets. It's not arranged according to how it historically happened. New Testament, you have the Gospels, Acts, the letters from the epistles, and then Revelation is the apocryphal literature. It's arranged according to the genre. I read a chronological reading plan, and it just helped me understand, especially the Old Testament story, so much better. And it helped me understand in context of even world history as things were happening and how it fits together. So I would encourage, read through the Bible once in your lifetime. I would strongly encourage finding a Bible, a chronological Bible reading plan. Or even another reading plan. Read through the Bible in a year or 2 years or 3 years. Don't be rigid about it. If you miss a day, don't, beat yourself up. Just get back on it and read more. I'm working through a Bible at home. I do book-by-book reading sometimes, and I've gone at varying paces. I've taken a break from that or did something else because of sermon prep, or I'm going to confess this, I miss days where I don't read it. And so it's going to take me 4 years to read through the whole thing. I have one book left. I'm working through Judges. So I really encourage just zooming out sometimes. Not all the time. Devotional reading might be what your soul needs. But every now and then, a big picture reading, I think, is really good. Now, sometimes zooming in. This may not be for everybody, but zooming in is when you look at specific details. So zooming in is like Bible study, this in-depth look. And there are more resources available today. It's time and intentionality, but for some of you, you might find it really rewarding or really like it. Maybe, you know, there's a little inner Bible nerd, and so it should be really good. I want to share a couple tips. Study begins with inquiry. Ask questions of the text. Like studying scripture, it begins with asking questions of the text. So who wrote it? What was the purpose of the writing? When reading, what things make you go, what? Like, when you read and there's something, sometimes I feel like we need to suppress those questions, like, oh, am I allowed to ask? No, when something, you read something and it causes you to go, wait, what's going on here? What does this mean? That's a good indication that there might be more going on. What do we learn about God? What do we learn about people or relating to God or others? Dive into the historical and cultural context of the passage. Maybe you read outside resources about the historical setting of the Babylonian Empire. Or maybe you read about Greek and Roman culture during the first century, during the time of Jesus. Or maybe you study some of the archaeological finds. You read about that or watch documentaries about archaeological finds that's related to Scripture. Dive into the historical cultural context. Another thing you go to is blueletterbible.org. I think I have some slides for this, and I don't know if they're in exact order. So, yes. So blueletterbible.org is a website. This is what I use for word study. I'm going to admit to you guys, I am not an expert in Hebrew or Greek. I took 2 semesters of Greek, and it didn't stick. So I go to Blue Letter Bible to do word studies. And you can type in the search bar. Oh, I'll turn it on. Up there, search bar, you can type in a verse. You can change the version of the Bible. That changes the English version. It does not change the original language it'll bring up. It just changes what you see in English. But when you go, so here's John 3:16. Over here, there's a button that says Tools. You click on that, it brings this up. And over here, it will have the original language. Over here, it has the English. You click on that, and it will give you a definition of that Greek word or Hebrew word if it's the Old Testament. This is what I use. This is my cheat code for you, okay? Like, this is what I use when I study, I do word studies. I go to blueletterbible.org. And once you click on that word, it will give you the definition, and then it will bring up a list of every other verse in the Bible where that word is used. And so it's a really useful tool, and it's free, blueletterbible.org. Another one is the Bible Project. I think I have a slide for that as well. That's where we watch that video. So thebibleproject.com. Guys, I cannot tell you how incredible this resource is. This resource is free, and I'm by no means a biblical scholar, but I had to do enough reading in seminary of sources and things that I can tell you the stuff they include in their videos is very accessible, but it's backed by some serious scholarship. So they have, on their website, they have Watch. You can go to theme videos. They have word study videos. They have overviews over every book of the Bible. And then they have other the videos I love because they're entertaining and they're easy to digest. But they also have blogs and other things. Then if you really want to go deep, you really want to be a nerd, they have the classroom option. You have to set up a profile, but it's free. And this is the equivalent. I've watched some of their classes. It's a virtual class. This is the equivalent of like a college Bible class. It is, and it's free. It's incredible. Like, I cannot recommend the Bible Project enough. And then another resource would be the Bema podcast is a really good resource for commentaries. Commentaries can be expensive, so another thing I do, I have a tablet and I have a library card. There's a couple library apps. I forget what they're called now. Libby and Hoopla. Sometimes, if I didn't want to buy a whole commentary, but I just wanted to study a passage for sermon prep, I've leased out a commentary on my library app and use that. So that's something you can do as well. So, sometimes we take a snapshot of scripture, we have a devotional reading. Sometimes we zoom out and we do these book by book or big picture or maybe follow a read through the Bible plan. And then sometimes we can zoom in, we can study the text, and there's so many resources available to study the text. And then there's developing, which we don't do this much anymore because we have digital photos that we just print. But once upon a time, you used to develop film, and then you would have a photograph. And those photographs, we often committed to memory. They were memorable stories or events that we took pictures of. So developing is my way of saying memorize Scripture. This is another way we can engage Scripture. Now, there have been different seasons in my life where I've done this more intentionally than others, but this is a really important practice to memorize and to commit some Scripture to memory. I'm also going to be honest with you, maybe this is unspiritual of me, but I don't focus all the time heavily on what I call the address, like the chapter and verse. I have a lot of Scriptures committed to memory that I know generally where they are, but I don't have the numerical chapter and verse exact. I know in 1 Peter it says, cast all of your cares on him because he cares for you. I know in Philippians 4 it says, do not be anxious about anything, and everything through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of Christ which transcends understanding will guide your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. I know in Isaiah 40 it says, fear not, or 43 I think, fear not, for I have redeemed you, I have called you by name, you are mine. I know generally where a lot of things are in the Bible, and I have chunks that are committed to memory. Sometimes I've done this intentionally. I've walked around with flashcards, or I had a little book that had memory verses in it that I carried, and I would dog-ear pages and just read them over and focus on that. But here's a cool thing. The other way things have been committed to memory is the more you do that zooming out reading or that even a devotional reading or the zooming in, the more you just read it, the more familiar you will become with the text. The more you read the Gospels, the more familiar you will be with Jesus' teachings and the miracles he did. The more you sort of saturate your life in it over time, you will find that there are just things committed to memory. But you can also do this intentionally. Maybe you walk around with flashcards. Maybe you put them in your note app on your phone. Or I know people have written them on their mirror so that when they wake up, they try to memorize the Scripture, and it's written and it's there. First thing in the morning, they see it on the mirror. But these are ways that we can engage Scripture. We can take a snapshot, do a devotional reading. We can zoom out, do big picture. We can zoom in and study it. We can also memorize, develop Scripture memory in our lives. Now, I want to encourage share a couple of resources because they're available on our website. This is where you can go to that other slide. So this is a screenshot from our website, lifepointgoshen.org. If you scroll partially down, there's this 2024 Bible reading plan. You can click on that. Did I have another slide? Yes, it'll take you to this page. And there are different Bible reading plans that you can download the PDF of. So there's a two-year chronological there, a book at a time, and then there's more if you scroll up. But then down here, I also have links. We put links to other Bible study resources. New Letter Bible, Bible Project, there's a couple books. Reading the Bible with Rabbi Jesus, How a Jewish Perspective Can Transform Your Understanding. It's a great book. There's some resources. That'll take you to the Amazon link. If you go to our website and click on that, there's some resources that you can access to help you engage Scripture more. So here's the point. I want to encourage you, we're not right at the top of the new year, but as we go into 2024, I want to encourage you to develop a rhythm of engaging Scripture. Seek to develop a consistent and regular rhythm of spending time in God's Word. So for you, maybe that's 7 days a week or an hour a day, and that is your regular, consistent rhythm. And to be honest with you, it's not my regular, consistent rhythm. Mine actually looks more like 5 days a week in the morning with my coffee. Sometimes I read a whole chapter, sometimes I read a couple chapters, and like I already admitted to you, sometimes I miss days. And I've just thrown off the burden of being rigid about that and carrying guilt or feeling like, oh, I missed days. I just get back up and get back in rhythm. Get back in rhythm and engage the Scripture and develop a rhythm that works for you. I use the zoom out, big picture. I read book by book, but sometimes I have to switch that up because sometimes staying in the Old Testament too long, I'm going to be honest with you, there's some parts that are a little tedious to work through. Sometimes like, you know what, we got to leave the Old Testament for a little bit, let's go hang out in Paul's letters, you know? So sometimes we got to switch it up, but the goal is not to be rigid, but to develop a rhythm of this being a priority and a regular thing other than Sunday morning when I talk about it, it being a regular part of your life. Again, not to be rigid, but to develop a rhythm of this being something that you engage with. So So I have some reflection questions. But before we dive into reflection questions, we're going to close here. So I'm going to invite Heather and the team to come up, and we're going to close in response. But I want to explore these questions as they come up. So number one, what would it look like for you to develop a more intentional rhythm of approaching the scriptures? What would that look like for you? And maybe to help answer that question is number two, are there rhythms of your daily life you already do that you could repurpose and devote to scripture? What if you listen, I know people who listen to audio version of scripture through the YouVersion Bible app. What if you listen to scripture on your commute to work? Or what if you read scripture during, someone told me about when they used to have their kids in pickup line, they would do their devotional time while they're waiting in the pickup line. What if you read scripture during the pickup line at your kid's school? If you're already sitting there, and normally you're just scrolling on social media, what if you just opened the YouVersion Bible app and you spent 5 minutes in scripture? Or what if you read a devotional on one of your breaks at work? Took maybe a 15-minute break, you took 10 or 5 even. I mean, even if it's just 5 more minutes than you already are spending, are there rhythms of your daily life you already do that you could repurpose? You get up and have coffee, and normally you're scrolling Facebook, but what if you just repurpose that time? You get up, you have coffee, and you scroll scripture. What would it look like? Are there rhythms of your daily life that you're already doing that you can just repurpose and engage scripture more fully? And number three, this is more of an imagine question. How might engaging scripture with a regular rhythm enrich your soul in the relationship with God? Like, what might be different about your inner life if you spent some intentional time in scripture? This morning, we're going to close. And the first Sunday of the month, we come to the table and we partake of communion. If you forgot that it was the first Sunday and didn't grab one of the individual cups when you came in, I just want to encourage you, if you want to partake, slip up your hand and the ushers will bring a cup to you. But as they do that, it's fitting to come to the table because we're talking about scripture and how it points us to Jesus. And when we come to the table, this ritual also points us to Jesus. It reminds us that we need Jesus. Just as much as we need bread or water, we need the bread of life. It also reminds us that our story is wrapped up in His story. And when we come to the table, our life is hidden in Christ through His death and resurrection. And then it reminds us of who we are. It reminds us that we are forgiven. In Jesus' name, His body was broken for you, His blood was shed for you, and in Jesus' name, your sins are forgiven. I'm going to grab my elements and we will take together. But the scriptures point us to Jesus just as our worship through song points us to Jesus and just as this ritual of coming to